Syriac Christians, of whom Ephraim the Syrian is, perhaps, the most representative. Ephraim, whose life spanned most of the 4th century, can best be described as a poet-theologian. His extant work, a selection of which has been available in English for more than a century, takes the exclusive form of hymns and homilies, as he is said to have abhorred the philosophical approach to theology such as the Greeks took. For this reason, while Ephraim conveys a fairly clear soteriological picture over the course of his work, it is somewhat less systematic than it is picturesque, and requires an eye or an ear predisposed to pick it up. We are fortunate, then, that we have already encountered Irenaeus, for Ephraim's thought is infused with his, and motifs first deployed by the Greek are indeed used by the Syrian as well. Much as I spoke of recapitulation as Irenaeus' defining doctrine, I want to begin our consideration of Ephraim's thought by talking about Christus Medicus, or Christ the Physician. Because even though, across Ephraim's work, there are innumerable symbols worthy of our attention, it is Christ the Physician that draws many of these together and proffers the most ready entry into his soteriology. Happily for us, to this end, Athelstan and Casho has compiled a very helpful book entitled Healing in the Theology of St. Ephraim, in which he includes a significant chapter called Salvation as a Process of Healing. Salvation as a process of healing. This in itself tells us a great deal about what we can understand about Ephraim's soteriology, but perhaps we might also listen to some of the Syrian writer's own words. This is hymn number 4 from his Hymns on Paradise. Adam had been most pure in that fair garden, but he became leprous and repulsive because the serpent had breathed on him. The garden cast him from its midst, all shining it thrust him forth. The high priest, the exalted one, beheld him cast out from himself. He stooped down and came to him. He cleansed him with hyssop and led him back to paradise. In this verse alone, it is possible to discern so much of what impelled Ephraim, even if it is not as explicit in its use of medical terminology. And yet the terminology is indeed there. First, however, I would ask you to take note of where this soteriological picture begins. It begins in the garden. Like Irenaeus, Ephraim turns for his starting point to the very commencement of the human story, and makes heavy use of Genesis. So it is for Ephraim that Adam represents all humanity and the purity that we were intended for. But as you might expect, this quickly shifts, and it is here that Ephraim first draws on medical language, calling Adam's fallen state leprous and repulsive. Fortunately for the human race, however, Christ's priesthood is therapeutic. And this is the important thing. Christ, the high priest, stooped down and cleansed him with hyssop. This is consistent entirely, I think, with Shemin Kasha's statement that, according to Ephraim, man needs to be healed and restored. He goes on to say that, during the Old Covenant, God provided medicine and physicians for his people. God sends chosen people like the patriarchs and prophets to act as physicians and to heal his people from their sickness. Finally, God sends his Son, Jesus Christ, who personifies the whole revelation of God, to save man from the wound of sin. Of greatest interest to us, though, is Shemin Kasho's conclusion of this passage. Jesus Christ, as the best physician, healer of all, and medicine of life, is capable not only of healing individual sicknesses, such as the prophets did, but he was able to heal Adam's wound and rescue humanity from its sick state to health. So, we meet in Ephraim Christ the physician, whose word restores health and presumably humanity's place in paradise. But I began by mentioning Ephraim and Irenaeus in the same breath, and the reason I did rests in something Sebastian Brock says in the introduction to his translations of the hymns of paradise, and which extends this mission of Christ from the mere restoration of humanity to its original place. Brock says, "The ultimate aim of the incarnation, however, was not just to restore Adam's humanity to paradise, but to raise humanity to the position of honor that Adam and Eve would have been granted had they kept the divine commandment." Ephraim puts the matter succinctly as follows. "The Most High knew that Adam wanted to become a god, so he sent his son to put him on in order to grant him his desire." These words, you may recall those of Irenaeus that I cited before, regarding God having become what we are in order to make us what he is himself. There is that exchange. Well, Ephraim makes them even more explicit. Again, I turn to Brahe, who quotes from Ephraim's 48th hymn on virginity. "Divinity flew down and descended to raise and draw up humanity. The Son has made beautiful the servant's deformity, and he has become a god, just as he desired." In the work of Ephraim the Syrian, it is clear that the end of Christ's healing mission is something more than a moral reinstatement. It is no less than the divinization of the human race. Now, roughly contemporaneous with Ephraim was an Alexandrian Greek named Athanasius. Indeed, you may have already encountered Athanasius as the man who identified the danger posed by his presbyteral compatriot, Arius. Regardless, though, the story goes that while Athanasius was a deacon and serving the Patriarch of Alexandria, Arius was a popular priest in the city who was preaching the inferior nature of the Son to God the Father. To Arius' credit, he was only trying to do justice to the scriptures, just as he was able to claim precedent for his views in the church's own tradition. But Athanasius was a combative deacon and not to be swayed. Calling on scripture and tradition himself, he responded that either Jesus Christ was God or the entire incarnation was a futile enterprise. And though it took an ecumenical council of the church to settle on it, and a very long time for it to gain universal acceptance, Athanasius' view did indeed win the day, and Arius' view was ultimately condemned. It will come as no surprise, then, that the written work for which Athanasius is most famous is entitled De Incarnatione, or On the Incarnation. And what is most significant about this is the development it represents of Irenaeus' formula of exchange. In Athanasius' case, it is transmitted as, "He became human that we might become divine." He became human in order that we might become divine. And in these words is embedded a Greek word that would come to characterize the whole field of Greek soteriology, namely theosis, also known as deification, the idea that human beings are created to dwell in union with God and then recreated in Christ to share in God's own nature. Human beings are created to dwell in union with God and then recreated in Christ in order to share in God's own nature. I am well aware that these are not the terms in which Western Christians are used to speaking about Christ's work. We are far more accustomed than the Latinists to such languages as atonement, propitiation, sacrifice, indeed, language that is considerably more compatible with what I first described as the highly distilled common narrative. And so it is worth calling to mind that soteriology can be spoken of and understood in altogether different, if complementary, ways. But I want at this point to return for a short time to what I assume is most of your comfort zone. For having met Irenaeus, followed by Ephrem in the Syriac East, the Athanasius in Greek Alexandria, it is time we gave some thought to Augustine. Augustine arrives on the scene, chronologically, a generation after either Ephrem or Athanasius. His is a story some of you may already know, but having begun adult life as a non-Christian in North Africa, he traveled to Milan, where, under the tutelage of Ambrose, he was converted to the Orthodox Christian faith. He then returned to his home, where he was made Bishop of Hippo in modern-day Tunisia. And the rest of his life was dedicated to thinking and writing about the faith, producing in the end a voluminous output, including some of the most important works of Christian literature of all time, including the Confessions and the City of God. He has been considered by many, in the Reformed tradition especially, as being the interpreter par excellence of St. Paul and the main church father upon whom Martin Luther would base his thought in response to Catholic abuses in the 16th century. Perhaps in light of this, it is not surprising that Augustine's default soteriological position is often considered to be one that speaks of redemption and justification above all. For surely those are the terms that derive most naturally from the Latin tradition Augustine so thoroughly represents. And yet, as Gerald Horner states in his entry on deification for Augustine through the ages, it is sometimes asserted that the concept of deification is unknown to Augustine and alien to Western Christian thought, which prefers to speak of redemption through justification by faith. In fact, Augustine teaches deification, and in Sermon 192.1.1, consciously or unconsciously, echoes Athanasius. He says there, to make human beings gods, he was made man who was God. And of course, such language is present in the traditional Western liturgy when the priest mingles water with the wine before the prayer of consecration by saying, O God, who didst create and yet more wonderfully renew the dignity of the substance of man, grant that by the mystery of this water and wine, we may become partakers of his divinity, who didst vouchsafe to become a partaker of our humanity. Yet, when we speak of Augustine, we rightly think of his response to Pelagius and the fact that his concern became more with Christ's mediatorial role than with his restorative, divinizing role. And in that difference in focus lies a gulf in understanding between the Greek conception of deification and Augustine's. You see, for Augustine, grace was something external to human beings, entirely unmerited, which had to be meted out, something that could be accomplished by God alone in Christ. Whereas to the Greek, grace was present in humanity simply by virtue of creation, and Christ's restorative work was to set it in its proper place again. Which is to say that when reading Augustine on something like deification, as similar as his words may be to those of Athanasius and Irenaeus, his meaning must be considered in light of a significantly different teaching on grace. The origin of grace, where grace resides, and how grace is communicated. Finally, though, in order to draw this highly selective survey of soteriology to a close, I wish to introduce you to the ideas of one more thing. Maximus the Confessor comes last on our timeline by around 2 centuries and represents, by some estimates, a synthesis of Greek and Latin sympathies, even if his soteriology is unequivocally Greek. It is appropriate that we should consider Maximus last and immediately after Augustine, as he does for Greek theology something analogous to what Augustine does for the Latin, in serving as what John Meyendorf calls as the real father of Byzantine theology. Meyendorf is able to say this because of Maximus's particular genius in drawing together an originistic, that is to say, Neoplatonic, conception of the cosmos with the traditions of less controversial representatives of the tradition. Of importance here, though, is what Maximus says about humanity and the work of Christ. And while it may be impossible to distill his thought down to something easily intelligible in this short period of time, there are a few things we might pick out. First of all, Maximus begins from a different place than someone like Augustine when talking about sin and redemption. Above all, whereas Augustine's faith was shaped by his experience in the world, Maximus was schooled in the ascetical way of the monk. For him, and I take this summary from my other reading, there was little sense of sin as something to be handed on and received. Rather, sin's mark in human beings was in their inherited mortality. Meyendorf goes on. The fall of man, who had been placed by God at the center of creation and called to reunify it, was the cosmic catastrophe that only the incarnation of the Word could repair. Christ's work, for Maximus, is a recapitulation. His thought goes back to a conception used by St. Irenaeus against the Gnostics 5 centuries earlier. The Logos, by whom and in whom all things were originally created, gives a new orientation and integration to the whole of creation by assuming it after it had abandoned the movement assigned to it by God. This essentially dynamic doctrine of salvation supposes a double movement, a divine movement toward man consisting of making God partakeable of by creation, and a human movement toward God, willed from the beginning by the Creator and restored in Christ. Ultimately, according to Maximus, the human vocation was to draw together created and creator, one might say, to serve as priest to all creation. But the possibility for doing so was lost to us due to Adam. Christ's work then was to restore the human race to its rightful place, making it possible for us to unite with God and, in the end, be deified. So, by now I hope to have given you a glimpse at the thought of 5 fathers of the Church, who, central as they were in their own lifetimes, remain central as we seek to understand to the fullest extent how we might best conceive of Christ's world, and so understand who human beings are in relation to God. You may consider this to be a task best left to Christians, but I would strongly argue that it is actually the task of any scholar who wishes to understand the ideas that have most compelled human beings since Christianity first appeared as a force in the Mediterranean world. I have proposed in the course of this lecture that the work of Christ was understood differently in different places, shaped as it was by the dominant influences of those places. And so I identified an Alexandrian, an Antiochene, and a Roman perspective. But I also said that while it was legitimate to do this, it was unhelpful to see the differences to the exclusion of recognizing synthesis. Yet I presented you with representatives of these different strains of thought, beginning with Irenaeus, followed by Athanasius, Augustine, and Maximus. I can assure you that infinitely more could be said about each and every one of them. But for now, suffice it to say that a dominant concern for each, beginning with Irenaeus, was the notion of deification shy of offering you an entire course of the subject. That, is where we're going to have to conclude this evening. Thank you for listening.